So this week's reading, which will go with Dharmarajan's talk, comes from our book, Rays of the One Light, that Swamiji wrote. It's available in our bookstore. And the title for this week, week 24, is How Devotees Rise. Truth is one and eternal. Realize oneness in it in your deathless self within. The following commentary is based on the teachings of Paramahansa Yogananda. Last week, we asked the question, why do devotees fall? And we considered the downfall of Judas in this context. Jesus, in answer to Judas's criticism for allowing Mary to rub his feet with spikenard, a very costly ointment, said, The poor always ye have with you, but me ye have not always. Jesus is saying here that there is one supreme injustice that needs eradication. Poverty, yes, but not of a material kind. Poverty in a spiritual sense. Divine blessings are not common in this world. They are extraordinary. When they come, we should give them priority above every other consideration. Never allow a moment of inner joy, for instance, to be set aside for lesser duties. Divine attunement is our highest priority. As Lahiri Mahashaya, the guru of Yoganandaji's guru, said, to listen to the heart's inner sound, Om, which issues from the very center of our being, is man's highest duty. Mary, on this occasion, was not communing in inner silence with Christ's spirit, as she had been when Martha urged Jesus to reproach her for not helping out in the kitchen. Mary this time was serving outwardly, but in a very different spirit from the restless fussing for which Jesus had reprimanded her sister Martha. Those who see a radical difference between the paths of action and meditation should understand this distinction. To serve in the right spirit is necessary, for only thereby can we overcome our karmic tendencies toward restless activities. So I'm going to repeat that sentence. It's so important. To serve in the right spirit is necessary, for only thereby can we overcome our karmic tendencies toward restless activity. The important thing is that the spirit be always inwardly focused, that in everything we act in loving service to the Lord. Therefore, the Bhagavad Gita in the third chapter says, the state of freedom from action, that is, of eternal rest in spirit, cannot be achieved without action. No one, by mere renunciation and outward non-involvement, can attain perfection. Whenever the Spirit of God descends upon you, however, remember the words of Jesus, me ye have not always with you. Thus, through Holy Scripture, God has spoken in mankind. Then we can say sing the three tones together that Master always sang after readings. It goes, Om, Om.
Good morning. You'll have to forgive me this little jump rope that I have here. Our regular cable broke, as it likes to. So this is the temporary but very solid cable. I wanted to begin with a reading from Whispers from Eternity, which is a book of poems by Master. And this one is, Come to me as Krishna, the divine cowherd. This is a book of prayer demands, as Master put it. We have a right to demand of our Father, Mother, God, lovingly, but still demand. I mean, when a child is hungry, especially when it's young, you don't see it say, Amma, is it okay if there might be a little bit of food sometime? It says, Amma, saprenge, hippovenum, I want it now. As you know, it's my right. Where does it produce it? The same kind of demand we can say to God. But as Master said, always with love, lest you hear a lightning bolt and then there's just a pile of ashes left. So this poem, this prayer demand, O Krishna, Lord of Hindustan, I sorrowed by the lonely Jamuna River, where thy flute notes thrilled the air and led lost calves to their divine home. O Lotus of Love, musing on the sad absence of thy delusion-dispelling eyes, I saw thine invisible spirit take form, frozen by my devotion's frost. Thy divine body of sky-blue light walked with feet of eternity on the banks of my mind, planting there the lasting footprints of divine realization. I am one of those lost calves which followed thy flower footprints on the shoals of time. Listening to the melody of thy flute of wisdom, I now follow the middle path of calm activity by which thou hast led many through the portals of their dark past into the eternal light. Since all souls belong to thy fold, whether we move forward, are sidetracked, or are hemmed in, unmoving, in the fogs of disbelief, O divine Krishna, or Krishna, lead us back to thy enfolding shed of everlasting freedom. O Krishna, thou reignest supreme on the heart throne of all those who know thy love. Today's reading, How Devotees Rise, is a very important topic for us to consider. And it comes after last week's reading, which we didn't read, which is Why Do Devotees Fall? And it isn't that we didn't read it on purpose, but you might think that we didn't read it on purpose. Why do devotees fall? Whoa, let's just leave that one aside. And sometimes you see people having different feelings that way, even when this reading comes up. Like, you know, suppose the email comes in your, you know, email box, the newsletter, why do devotees fall? We sometimes have even heard people say, that's not my favorite reading. And we might ask ourselves, well, why even have that reaction? And it's a natural reaction. I don't criticize it. And I thought about that because on the one hand, we could say, well, why do devotees fall? I want to know, so I don't do that. I mean, what more useful thing could there be? But sometimes there is a, let's not go there, please. And the reason why, I think, one of the reasons why, is because we don't want to fall. And why don't we want to fall? Why do we have an emotional reaction to it? Because intellectual, yes, I would not like to fall. But no, there's a ooh in there, in the heart sometimes. And I think it's because we have a fear of falling, or we have an aversion to falling, or we have a memory of falling. And we all do in the past, so it's not anyone should be singled out or feel like, yeah, but you didn't fall as bad as I did, let me tell you. It's not like that. Sri Yukteswar said, I think Master said this was his favorite quote in the, yes, Master said this was his favorite quote in the autobiography of a yogi, his own autobiography of Sri Yukteswar, saying, forget the past. The vanished lives of all men are dark with many shames. Everything, human conduct is ever unreliable until rooted in the spirit. Everything in future will improve if you are making a spiritual effort now. Everything, no matter how bad things look, if you are making a spiritual effort now, they're going to improve. They are improving. A friend of mine was asking, you know, kind of saying, it's hard because I do these spiritual things and then nothing good really happens. It still seems to be really bad. And I ask for help and I don't really seem to get it. And it's still very hard. And I know her well, and so I know a little bit about her life from things she's shared. So I took it a little bit lightheartedly. I said, well, what about that time she was in her meditation and saying, Divine Mother, I am really having a hard time. I need some good news. And at that moment, her son walked into the room and said, "Guess what, Mom? Good news." And then he read something that he had just discovered that had an impact in their life. And she thought, well, that was fast. So I said, what about the good news thing? That seemed to happen right away. She said, okay, yes, that's true. But there comes a certain point as a devotee when we realize even if doing the right thing, all things will in future will improve if you're making a spiritual effort now. Even if I'm making a spiritual effort now and things are not appearing to improve, what choice do I have? When we acknowledge, as Sri Yukteswar said, the inescapability of divine law, we simply know, although every day we dedicate ourselves to a deeper understanding, if I go this way and do the right thing, it will help. And do I want to do the wrong thing because the right thing isn't going to work? No. I just have to have that faith that it's not only devotion out of love. It's also devotion out of wisdom. Why do the wrong thing? It's only going to come back and haunt me anyway. I say this in cases where we have enough distance from the situation to choose our action. Of course, there are many situations where we act wrong unknowingly, or we are attracted to a pattern of behavior that isn't helping us. So that's a different kind of challenge. But I mean, even if things don't appear to improve, they are improving. If nothing else, we are paying off a heavy karmic debt that once paid is paid and finished. And if you've ever paid off a debt before, even a financial one, the day you pay that last payment, ha! You just feel this freedom of just, it's over, it's done, and fine. And I mean it, though, when I say that the vanished lives of all men are dark with many shames. I had a strange counseling request once. Someone said, my brother is about to go to prison on Monday, and I'd like you to talk to him. And, you know, I mean, normally it's sort of like I'm having trouble with, you know, my son, he won't study. Instead, it's like, he's going to prison, what can you tell him? So I thought, gosh, what? What can you say? She didn't tell me why. And I had learned, strangely, from another friend who had gone to prison, you don't ask why. So I didn't ask him why. And I could see, as soon as he came in, he was completely just... as you can imagine, he was terrified, first of all, but he was also very ashamed. And on the one hand, karmically, you end up going to prison. Presumably, there's a reason. I know innocent people go to prison and all that, but even saying that, there is some karma in there, even for the innocent, that brings them into prison. And I don't say it with a judgment, but I just say something in life brought him to that state. And my heart immediately went out to him. And I just said, listen, you need to, you know, atone for whatever you did. You're paying off this karma in this way. But don't feel too badly about it. Feel remorse if it's appropriate. Regret what you did. Resolve not to do it again and all that. But don't feel too badly. I said, everybody's gone to prison. Maybe not in this lifetime, but we've all gone to prison. So don't feel like you're the bad one and everyone else is walking around fine. We just either happen to not get in trouble this time or not get caught. And I was being a little bit light. But just to say, because walking around like this, bowed down, was not going to help him heal. And so that was one thing, and I felt it very sincerely. And so in this same way, we can sometimes have an aversion to making those spiritual mistakes. Why? Because we say either I remember doing it or I might do it. I could see myself doing it and I don't want to. And that can be helpful as long as we take it in the right way. So if you're not too familiar with the story of Judas, or even if you are, the way Master explained it is as follows. Now, Judas was one of Christ's 12 disciples. And this holds true for any guru-disciple relationship, not just that of Christ and his disciples. So in that way, it's very special to any time we can hear about the guru-disciple relationship, of course, because many of you are here disciples. it's always food for thought. It's always personally helpful for us to think about. Judas was a great soul. Master said so. He's painted as the great villain. And he did a villainous thing. I don't mean he was a great soul and his treachery was somehow missing. No, his treachery was a bad thing. But Swami asked Master, was Judas a prophet? Or was Judas a high soul? And Master said he was a prophet. He had to be one of the 12 disciples of Christ. And so the mistake that Judas made was as follows, as Yogananda explained it, and even as Dharmini read in the reading earlier about treachery. She said treachery comes from attachment to material desires or to material realities. Judas was of a more noble caste than the rest of the disciples. He was sort of more with the in crowd. And I said he was one of the 12 disciples?
No, he's the one that betrayed Jesus.
Okay, so in case it wasn't clear, Judas was the one who betrayed Jesus. I said treachery, but yes, thank you. So remember to edit the video. So Judas was the disciple. Judas was the disciple who betrayed Jesus. So... Now it's even worse because they'll be like, now why are they all laughing on the video? Oh well, never mind. So how did that betrayal come about?
I don't think I've ever seen that before. I've never seen you do that.
What advantage or disadvantage of having a cold? I'm not sure. So Judas, no, come on, Sai Ravi. His laughs go on and on and on, and it's impossible to keep a straight face when he's laughing. Okay, so laugh away. Judas was more with this sort of more political in a way too. He was concerned about the powers that be, and he thought Jesus is always mixing with these rabble, and not just the disciples, but others too. Why not, you know, spend a little time with the chief minister, or, you know, spend a little time with the politicians or the rich people? You know, it could help the cause. And Jesus always stayed away from that. He knew what he was doing. And Judas finally felt, because he believed in Jesus, and he kept wanting Jesus to really reveal himself, to show that he was the King of the Jews, as the prophecy said, to really rise to power, to even perform miracles in front of some of these doubters, but again, to show his divine power. And Jesus kept refusing to do that. In a certain sense, he didn't say it in this case, but don't tempt the Lord. Which means, you know, which often you hear from people, I'll believe in God as soon as he shows me one miracle. I had a cousin of mine say that to me. If there's a God, let him make a miracle, then I'll believe. And even Lahiri Mahashaya's friends in Autobiography of a Yogi said, we don't believe in all this. And Lahiri Mahashaya said, fine. Babaji said, whenever you call me, I'll come. And so he called Babaji, and Babaji came. And this is a beautiful story, but though he came, and though many of those friends of Lahiri's were converted in that moment to believing in God, Babaji said to Lahiri, do you call me for a trifle? It's easy to believe if you see miracles in front of you. There's no effort involved then. And he said, from now on, I will not come whenever you call me. I will come whenever you need me. And in fact, he proved that too later on. But just to say that we don't demand God because there's no love in that. That's why. Show me a miracle if you're so great, huh? There's no love in that. And do we love someone only because of what they give us? And then if they don't give, then we don't love? I mean, even in a human relationship, that's petty. So much more so with the nearest of the near, as Master said of God. So, going back to Judas, he was trying to get Jesus to do this. And finally, he said, And I say, why do I say this? Because he's often portrayed as just a thief, even. It even says he was a thief and watched the money and cared all about the money. And Master said no. Though he had that delusion, his real motivation in betraying Jesus was he thought if he could get the authorities to try to capture Jesus, that then Jesus would have no choice but to reveal his powers. And not only to save himself, but also to sort of save all the disciples. So he hatched a little plot or cooperated with the authorities to say, okay, fine, I'll make this confrontation happen. And so how horrified was he when Jesus, instead of revealing his powers, went with the authorities and was later killed? I mean, Judas never, ever saw that coming. We have evidence of this also. You could say, well, Master said that, but is it true? Judas killed himself afterwards. And now this is an important point of the story too. Master said he should not have. He said, though he did the greatest sin really there is of treachery, especially treachery of the guru, still, he said, he should have gone to the mountains, meditated, and asked for forgiveness and practiced, you know, repentance to just and regret and all that. That would have been a better use of his life. It would have been the right thing to do. He just heaped more onto himself by killing himself. So keep that in mind, that if you blame yourself, that Master said even Judas should have just meditated and said sorry. So nothing that any of us have done is anywhere near compared to that. And here the story continues, that Master said of the soul, Judas, of this same person, he said, I met Judas in this life. He said he was a disciple of a master in India. And in fact, he was still a little bit attached to money. And some of the disciples also of that master teased this reborn Judas 2,000 years later. And his guru, you know, said to leave him alone. He suffered enough. Don't tease him for that. And Master said that soul was liberated in this lifetime. Liberated. Free. Done. A jivan mukta in this lifetime after 2,000 years that were probably pretty tough. But in fact, partly it was because they were tough that he was then later liberated. He was paying off that heavy karma, and he was probably also burning out of his system any desire to do that again. Sometimes when we go through a very heavy test, it is to cure us of any attraction to that wrong line of thinking. So for example, suppose we are sweet and innocent angels, which of course we all are, that never do anything wrong and never wish any harm on anyone. And yet there are these troublesome people in our lives who speak harsh words and are unkind and so on. And if they weren't there, then everything would be just fine. Sometimes we can say, yes, God put them there because I am harsh too, and so they're harsh back at me. Sometimes that's true. Sometimes, though, they're put there for other reasons. Because, for example, suppose we have a tendency to be critical of others. Not verbally, maybe, but mentally. But then we find all this criticism coming at us verbally. And then we say, well, why? I didn't say anything. I had a friend once who was in a bad mood and at work, just... And another friend came out of her office and said to this friend, look, can you please either cheer up or go home? And said, I didn't say anything. She said, it doesn't matter. You're like stinking up the place with your crummy attitude. Because as we get sensitive, we start to know what other people are going through, even if they're not expressing it. And so we can simply say, I didn't say anything. And yet we find this energy because God says, look, you thought it, that's 90%, so you didn't say it. Now listen, if you have a tendency to speak rashly, it is a good thing to not. It's okay to just go. That's fine. That's a huge improvement. I mean, I had a student once who had this tendency not only to speak rashly, I mean, when I was a school teacher, a young student, child, not only speak rashly, but to hit. And so he would always hit because someone provoked him. And so I would always find that the kids would be like, nee, 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 when I wasn't looking, and then pow, and then he was the one in trouble, and they were crying. I don't know why. It's a weird kind of game that ends in you getting hit and crying. But anyway, I don't know. I said to them, to him, don't hit. I said, and why? Not just because it's wrong, but because if you don't hit, then they're the ones that get in trouble. If you tell me he said this horrible thing, I'm going to speak to him. But as soon as you hit him, it's all ruined. And I spoke to the other kid anyway, but still. And so I said, just run around or run to me or sit on your fists, but stop yourself from acting. And so he did. And so he'd be like, don't run. Yeah, he said a bad thing, you better do something, I'm going to hit him. Just like, okay. So it's like we need that level of self-control, certainly. But even in the thoughts, we want to be kinder. We want to be gentler and more understanding of others and accepting of others. Now, so another thing that can happen, suppose we have a tendency not to criticize others, but to criticize ourselves. And, you know, be compassionate towards others, but if we do even the slightest thing wrong, I'm terrible, and so on. And so then, we might have harsh people in our lives who are continuing to be unfair and unkind in the same way that we are being to ourselves. And they are an outer expression of what's going on in our own minds. I don't mean that they don't really exist, and as soon as you cure yourself of that habit, the person disappears. No, I don't mean that. But I mean, that's why they're in our lives. Because it can be. Because they are showing us how stupid this pattern of behavior is that we're having in our own minds. And since we're not getting the lesson in a subtler way, it's being embodied in the form of this relative or other relative or a third relative. No, I'm sorry. It often comes from relatives, actually. But that this is where it comes, but it's because this tendency is in ourselves. And as we cure that and as we heal that, I don't mean that it removes them from responsibility, but that their karma is not really our concern. It's our own healing. And so we may find that as we heal that inside ourselves, that either the person stops or they move to Rajasthan, or it just doesn't bother us anymore. And so again, keep that in mind. It's not just that we're quote unquote being punished with a weird situation, a hard situation, that's because we did the same exact thing. That's simplistic. It can be, but it can also be these more subtle things. And so I say that also because Judas was too hard on himself despite what he did, that being so egregious. And similarly, we should not be too hard on ourselves. Because when we are too hard on ourselves, it's just negative ego. What I mean is it's ego. Positive ego, you might say, and I don't mean positive good. I mean positive like affirming, like, well, I am so great, after all. That's positive ego. And negative ego is, well, I am so horrible. It's the same thing, emphasizing the behavior, but just in a negative way instead of a positive way. Once in Ananda Village, there was a woman who, a dear soul, but she had done something during a Sunday service that was somehow embarrassing to Swami Kriyananda. I don't know, did she forget his cup or something? I don't know what exactly happened, but it was kind of an embarrassing moment that she had caused. And she felt very badly about it, and you know, everything kind of went on. But a week later, at the next Sunday service, she didn't come. And Swamiji asked, well, where is this person? And someone said, well, sir, you know, she's still feeling badly about what happened last week. And he said, what ego? Meaning, of course you're going to make mistakes. We all make mistakes. You don't have to dwell on it. You don't have to hold it to yourself and say, gosh, I'm so terrible because of it. He probably even said, go and get her. Or I'm sure he spoke to her later. He hadn't held on to it. it's something, I don't mean that we should make mistakes and go, oh, well, it doesn't matter. But at the same time, to just go, no, it really matters. It's just, it's not useful. And it's just as separative of us from God as affirming our superiority and all those things is too. So, and one thing to keep in mind about how devotees rise, one point we already have now is whenever you fall, just dust yourself up off and stand up and keep going. And also you may want to reevaluate what it means to fall. Because really, as they say, a slip is not a fall. And so often, sometimes, if we have a tendency to beat up on ourselves, we may slip and take it as a fall, when really it's just a slip. It's not a big deal. And also not to identify with that. There was a woman who left Master. She was a nun. She left Master. She got married. She had a child. And then, this has all happened while Master was in India. For the 1935, 1936, for about a year and a half. When Master came back from India, he landed on the East Coast, he found this disciple with her daughter and said, come back home. And he brought them both back to Mount Washington area. She lived in a separate house and her daughter too. But they were, and some of the other nuns though said, how can you dare to show your face? And she said, do you expect me to worship my mistakes? And it's the truth. We need not worship our mistakes. Okay, I made a mistake. Fine, I'm back again. Here I am. And, you know, sometimes I'll say to myself, like, you know, this isn't so relevant now, but in the beginning days when I was trying to meditate every day, and then I would get into a busy time or whatever, a mood, something, and I would miss a few days meditation, and I would start to go, oh, I can't believe I didn't meditate again, and oh. And instead I would meditate when I would then get back on the horse, as we say, pick up the habit again and meditate that next morning, I would say, okay, great. Since now, I have meditated every morning. I mean, it's only one morning, but one out of one. Just you reset the counter and just say all that other stuff, zero. One, day one. This is, today is day one. I have been meditating every day on day one. And in that way, find ways to encourage ourselves. Forget the past. Now, another way that we rise is not just, and the way we rise is not the way you climb a mountain where, you know, every aching movement is up to us and we have to climb and then if one slip, whew, finished. Or that it's, in other words, that it's all by our self-effort, it's all against gravity. That is not the case when we are rising as devotees. There is an upward stream, an upward current that we can tune into, that we can move into, and that also helps us to rise. You see? So it's more a question of entering into a positive flow, the positive flow towards God that exists for all of us. And that is like a wind, which can't really blow you up the mountain, but maybe you have like a sail or a hang glider or something, but or you can think of it as a crane on the top that you just, you know, reaches down and plucks you up and brings you to the top. That is, that flow exists on many different levels. That ray of grace, that flow of grace that brings us to God is something we just have to enter into. It takes effort. It definitely takes effort, but you can think of it as swimming in a river current. If you swim with the current, you still have to paddle and you still have to stay afloat, but the river is taking you to the ocean, the infinite ocean. And so, on the other hand, we can get out onto the banks and start walking back the other way. And or we can swim against the current and not get very far. But that current, the downward current, is there too. So really, it's we're either moving towards God or away from God. But what I want to emphasize is that it's very easy to move towards God. It isn't that we have to claw our way. Not only as we move towards Him, is He moving towards us, is He pulling forward, but again, there's this positive stream. One way Master expressed it was, stay in tune with me, the Guru, he was saying. attune yourself. And someone asked Swami, what did Master exactly mean by attunement? And Swamiji said, you know, he never really said. But we know what it means to attune to something. Even when the choir sings, there's that first note, and everyone in the choir hums the note, so we all start on the same note. Otherwise, it's pick a note, any note, and let's start singing. Well, no, doesn't sound as good then. And so, just to, as you're tuning an instrument, or if you're playing together, the first thing you do is check that the instruments are, attuned to each other. So in that same way, Master said, attune yourself to the Guru. That keeps you safe. That keeps you in that positive flow. And that also is a guideline for when we don't feel safe, or we don't feel even cheerful, or we don't feel even interested in the Guru, or we feel just negative. Instead of worrying about those thoughts and beating ourselves up or just feeling them, you can say, I have these thoughts, but they're not me. Sometimes I'll have negative thoughts, and if I'm lucky, I'll catch them and say, this isn't me. I don't think this way. I don't like being this way. I'm not even interested in this, and yet they're coming. So I separate myself from those thoughts, and I just move. I mean, and I'm going to do something positive. Like, let me get up and move. Maybe that'll help move the energy. Let me meditate. Let me pray. Let me chant. Let me listen to a talk of Swamiji's. Let me talk to Dharmini, or let me call someone and see, you know, to see if there's something I can do for someone, even though these thoughts are still there. But let me enter into that positive stream, and it just takes me away without having to solve why I was in a mood because I ran out of dosa batter and how it just proves how life is so rotten. I mean, it's just like, that's just nothing. Now, not every challenge can be solved that way in terms of that some of them are big and there's some things we have to face in ourselves and work out and heal. So it isn't just that, but even with those, moving into a positive flow will take us up the mountain enough that we can see from a higher perspective, oh, you know, well, I don't want to be that way anymore. I see it in a larger context now. And so this is also true. You see it, the third thing I wanted to mention is, in terms of how devotees rise, is spending time in that positive flow. One specific way is to do exactly what you've done, is to come here, is to spend time with other devotees. Master said, Kriya Yoga, you know, your own personal meditation practice, is absolutely essential for freedom. Your own effort, in other words, is what I mean. But just as helpful is satsang, company of truth, company of truth seekers, and again, company of guru bhais. As fellow seekers on the path, we strengthen each other when we come together. And you feel that. If or perhaps you feel that, you know, coming in, speaking personally, coming in a bad mood, saying, well, at least I better put a smile on my face just because I don't want to be embarrassed. Hi, no, I'm feeling okay. No, I feel great, actually. How are you? And suddenly, we do feel better. Now, I don't mean that comes in here when I see you in the hi, no, I am very happy to see you when you come in. But just to say that spending time with other positive, sincere people helps us. Because often we're in situations where we have challenges to deal with from the people in our lives. And one thing also you notice easily in terms of this positive stream, when you start meditating, you find often that your heart becomes softer. Your heart becomes more open. Sometimes you'll find tears will come that you don't know why they're coming. And sometimes it's out of devotion, and sometimes it's because a hurt that you've had for a while is being released. But then also we get the complaint from people, listen, now that I'm meditating, my feelings get hurt all the time now. Much more easily than when I wasn't meditating. What's that about? I thought this was supposed to help me. Well, one of the things is that as the heart softens, sometimes we feel harshness that we had previously just kind of walled ourselves in so we didn't have to feel it. And we say, well, it was better when I didn't feel it. You know, it wasn't. It's not. self-evidently, now that we're healing, the heart is saying, I can't just stay slammed shut and operate at one horsepower. I have to open, I have to expand. And part of that means feeling now these things that I have walled out before. Sometimes it leads us to make necessary changes in our lives. Sometimes it helps us to become more calm and face that, yes, this person acts this way, and yes, it bugs me every time. I can either give them a piece of tape for the mouth so they won't ever speak to me that way, or I can work on how can I practice calmness. What is it in me that's reacting to what they're saying? And I don't mean to say blame ourselves in a harsh way, because look, harsh words, hurtful things are hurtful. But how do we move through that more calmly? It's a great skill if we can. And so, but we also find it in ourselves that we may have had a tendency just to poke at friends like, oh, just like that. And that now when we do it, our heart kind of cringes a little bit, that we feel, even if everyone else is doing it, that's it, oh yeah, that's it, that we, yeah, I can't do it. I can't join in the massacre because my heart hurts. It doesn't want to do that anymore. We also may find our words in general, we used to perhaps speak more sarcastically, just as a way of having fun, or speak harshly or tease someone, and that, not only do we not get as much fun out of it, but we can't quite bring ourselves to do it. Or if we do, we feel the heart has a little bit of regret. Why are you doing that? I was a school teacher, as I mentioned, and whenever we would have new kids come into the school, they would sometimes have that rough and tumble energy from their previous jail. I mean, school. You know, but some schools are like that, just like, all the prisoners together and so on. And so they would come in and be, of course, very afraid of the new jail at first, until they realized we were all nice, and then they'd be, ah, no rules, great. And then they would go on and acting however they wanted, and they found there were all kinds of rules. Not that we spelled out, but it was a culture. It was a school culture. It wasn't a Ananda school. And it was a culture just as Ananda has, a culture of kindness, a culture of respect that we all strive to maintain naturally as a consequence of meditation, not because, now you better be kind if you want to stay here. Obviously not. But the unkindness really stuck out. And so in this one kid came in, and he was sitting right in front of me in the classroom, and I asked the kids some question about math, I think it was, and somebody, you know, raised her hand, and I called on her, and she said, I don't know, it was like, you know, what's the square root of 16? And she said 5. And I said, well, you know, it's not quite 5. It's a lot like 5. It's near to 5, but it's not exactly 5. And the kid, the new kid, turned around and went at her, as if to say silently, like, you idiot or something. I don't know. Maybe I turned. I don't know why he would do it right in front of me. Either he was that blind, or maybe he didn't think I would catch him, or maybe I turned and someone's making a face. I don't know. But I just turned and I saw him do it, and I just instinctively, I said, you know, we don't really do that here. And he just went, ugh! I turned bright red, and his eyes started to fill up with tears, and just he was so embarrassed, which was not my intention at all. But it was almost like that effect of that hurtful thing just rebounded and came right back to him. And it was also a calm witnessing, why are you like that? Why would you do something like that? And just, I don't know. I remember once I, as a student in high school, was very sarcastic in this one class and like, yeah, trying to act cool. And then the teacher held me after class and said, that's it, I'm going to see you after class. And, and the others were like, yeah. And so I had proved I was bad enough. It's part of the culture sometimes of the youth, and certainly in America it was for those people that I was hanging out with. So I kind of, you know, went up to the teacher at the end of class, and she said, why do you act that way? And I said, it's not your fault.
It's my fault. I don't know why I act this way. It's stupid. And she just said, yeah, I mean, it doesn't help me. It doesn't help the class. I know. And I couldn't do it anymore. I did it in other classes, but I couldn't do it in her class. I couldn't do it in her class anymore. She took all the fun out of it. And so then we became friends. She started joking. There was a picture of her with her dog. I mean, picture of her dog with a child. And I said, oh, is this your son? She said, yes, this the boy. What she said, and she pointed at the dog and said, and this is my firstborn. And I mean, it's totally shocked me. She was kidding, of course, but that a teacher would make a joke and so on. And so we just became friends. So in that same way, we find that happening to ourselves and go with that, even if it means now we're a little more vulnerable than we used to be. It's for the good. It's for our healing. And the more you spend time this way, you get strengthened to the point where if somebody is acting in a strange way, it sticks out to you. You go, well, I don't know why you're having such a bad day that you should say something like that. It doesn't affect me. I have a place where I meditate. I have friends who I spend time with who are also seeking these things and who wouldn't act that way. So it's your behavior that's anomalous as opposed to kindness sticking out as unusual in our lives. So keep these thoughts in mind. And when you have that, when you feel that grace, when you feel that opportunity, when you have that opportunity to come or to spend time meditating or spend time listening to Swami, take that opportunity. As Master said, these blessings are rare in this life. And so when you feel that, go with it, because it's drawing you into that stream of healing grace.